For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. Welcome to This Awakened Generation with your host, Mazino Abraham Egbuoku.
It's not about you. You, zero. Like somebody said, I don't know where I read this, but the meaning of the cross is I is canceled. You gotta go. Out of the equation, you don't matter. I don't care about you. But I care about you in a different way. I care about you as long as I can take you to the cross. And we can both go to the cross together. And the cross is where I is canceled. The cross is where you die to this world and the world dies to you. Is this what is happening? Do we know that if you don't overcome the world, you are not sitting in God's throne with him? Do you know that? I am praying ceaselessly. So, prayer warriors, they come for prayer meeting all the time. I'm in my house. We are praying, oh God, that we'll walk worthy of the Lord unto our pleasing. If that is what is happening in this church, I think we're doing something right. I'm not judging. You judge for yourself. If that is what is happening, if it's not what is happening, then we are in problems. If that's not the state of our hearts, and it's not enough to just do it religiously, it must be a passionate desire, because you know that this is who you are, and this is what you are. This is your identity. And that's why I said there has been a loss of identity. The whole essence of church, you know what church? I think in the first message I started out that. The word ecclesia. That's the meaning of church. It's Greek. Ecclesia. You know what it is? The called out ones. That scripture is gotten from 2 Corinthians chapter 6. From verse 14 downwards. You see, it tells us clearly. What does light have to do with darkness? Why can you be unequally yoked with... This is who you are. Excuse me. You cannot... What fellowship with righteousness and unrighteousness? Communion with light and darkness. Just rush through it quickly. Don't stop. What accord with Christ and Belial, part of with believer and infidel? What agreement temple of the God with idols? For you are the temple of living God. And God has said, this is what you must see. I will dwell in them. I will walk in them. I will be their God and they shall be my people. So what happens? Therefore or wherefore, come out. Come out. Tell your neighbor, come out. Come out from among them and be separate. You must be separate. You must be different, saith the Lord. And touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. This is New Testament. Somebody will tell you this is Old Testament. This is New Testament. It's New Testament doctrine. It's the foundation of New Testament. Listen, this is the very foundation of New Testament. And I will be your father. Listen, God is not your father. Listen. He didn't say, and I am. Please go back again to 16. Listen to it carefully. 16. I will dwell in them, I will be their God, they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them and be separate, and touch not the unclean thing. And what will happen? It is then that I will receive you. Then not only will I receive you, I will now be your father. And unto you, and you will be my sons, and you will be my daughters. And you know what the next verse tells us? That's chapter 7, verse 1. He says, having therefore, that means it's linked still. Having therefore these promises, what promises? The promises that if you come out from among them, he will show himself as God to you. The reality of God has lost us because we've lost our identity. Where there is loss of identity and loss of purpose in the church, it equates to a loss of God. Say anything you want, the church at large is in an Ichabod state. It is generally in a state where the loss of God and his glory is there. That is why everything is so difficult. It's difficult to pray for a sick person. It's difficult to heal the dead, raise the dead. Yeah. There was a time it was not a big deal. It's difficult to even witness. To preach gospel, you walk around the street like Jehovah's Witness. You go around and tell anybody, you go this way. Everybody's so hardened. Those days, you just enter and you just say, the prayers of God can invade a space. And it was not by might. It was never by power. Listen, you cannot bring somebody to this. This is a very foolish gospel. This gospel is foolishness to anybody's understanding. That one man came one day, then he died on the cross, and that means it's your sins. Erase that from your mind. Just imagine we are living in the days of Jesus. Pastor Bruno just comes, and then they beat him, and they say he's a bad guy, and they beat him that he's spoiling our doctrine, and they killed him. They say he's a criminal. But so another group of people, Peter and Paul, they say, no, that dying that they beat him, that crucifixion, is for your sins. And it's for the sins of the whole world. You have to be foolish to believe such things. You have to be foolish. Do you know that this gospel is a miracle that you believe it? Yeah. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. It says, and you come back here please. The natural man receiveth not the things of God. You know why? They are foolishness to him. The gospel is a foolish something. It takes somebody that has been touched of God to accept this. That Jesus died, then on the third day he rose again, then he ascended to sit on the throne. That is what makes our experience real. Because we know, Peter says, you have not seen him, but yet you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. You know in whom you have believed. You know, you see, I was looking at a friend the other day. This guy is a gruesome sinner. But Jesus, a murderer, a killer, a wicked man of the highest order, bloodthirsty, cold-hearted. But Jesus one day came in. He believed. His life has changed. Now he's a tender, meek lamb. Is that a careless thing? Is that a joke? Is that an accident? The reality of Christ is pure by faith. It's by of God. We will never to carry this gospel. This gospel, you have no... See, in the truest sense of the word, we have no right or business preaching this gospel without the reality of God. When he was ascending, after he ascended, you know what he told them? He said in Acts chapter 1, wait in Jerusalem until you are endued with power. Don't be in a hurry. I am in a hurry. I want to preach the gospel. But I can't preach this gospel without power. So on the first day that the baptism of the Holy Ghost came upon them, you know what was happening? They were speaking in other tongues. And many of these tongues were the languages of people. That was the first miracle. By the next day, they were raising people who were sick. God was able to show, I'm with these people. Oh. You can't doubt it. Oh. Why do we think we should settle for less? Because we are not in the right place. And we are not ready to pay the price for the right thing, purpose and power. If our generation can capture what the Spirit of the Lord is trying to say through these messages, we will come back to a place of true seeking to regain our identity. Now let me go on. This identity is an identity of holiness. It says, having therefore these promises, what? Let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of flesh and of spirit. That just simply means of action, manifestation. You know, the things you do, physical things that manifest. And then of spirit, of things you think about. The things you conceive, your imaginations, casting evil imaginations down, your thoughts. So that you, like I was sharing while I was in the village to a group of people, I was saying to them, I say, you know, it's very possible for one man to come and say, hey, you know, I hate money. I don't like it because the Bible says you must hate money. You know, you must hate love of money. It says you must hate mammon. You must either love one or hate the other. You have to hate one. There's covetousness. How do they rhyme? That's what he's talking about. Filthiness of flesh and spirit. God wants to deal with both the root and the fruit. So many people are taking things that are not theirs. You are coveting things that have no business with you. You know they are not yours. But outwardly you find a sensible reason. And they didn't catch me, or they didn't do this, or they didn't do that. Let your heart be delivered. You won't need that. Hallelujah. And guess what? It says, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. So all that he's talked about is, so we have these promises. Promises that God has promised to be with us. Promises that God has promised to be our God. Why? Because we are not perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Why? Because he has chosen us. Remember we read in Ephesians? In him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy. So the whole calling of the believer is to be holy before the foundation of the world. That means our duty, our expertise. The expertise of the church is the perfection of holiness. How can we perfect this thing called holiness? This thing that Peter talks about in 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3 and 4. That they have given to us precious promises. Can you see this? Remember, having these promises. Oh, okay, go there. According to his divine power, has given all things that pertain to life and godliness. Go to verse 4. He says, wherefore, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. Did we read that just now? Why? That by these we might be partakers of the divine nature. What's the divine nature? Holy, holy, holy. And guess what? When we are partakers of the divine nature, we escape the corruptions that are in the world through lust. Because the world is lust. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eye, and pride of life. But it's the calling that he has given us promises. Today the promises are now used for what? Generally emptiness. Generally worldliness. Generally no different from the same things the Gentiles are trying to do and gain. Knowing full well that God, you see, I say a lot of the prayers that go on around us is abominable. Yes. See, my children are in school. One is now in the university. This is the end of the month. Every month I have to send him money in university. It is a dereliction of my duties for him to have to be begging me every month to send him his money. I will take care of my child by the grace of God. It's my responsibility. Except I'm totally broke or something. But God is not broke. We are insulting God. He knows what he needs to do. All the things we are trying for, beg and fast and pray for years, it's a lie. You go and perfect holiness in the fear of God. Go and answer your calling as a saint. A set apart one. Look at Hebrews chapter 12 quickly. Let me just go straight to 10. Quickly, I need to do one or two scriptures before I round up. Hebrews 12, 10. Verse 9 says, you know, the fathers of old and blah, blah, blah. Let's go to 10. Now, for they, that's the fathers, natural fathers, they chastened us after their own pleasure, but God, for our profit. So God chastens you. Remember, prior to this, he has said to you, if you are not chastening, from verse 5, if you don't allow him to chasten you, you are a bastard. That, I actually tell people, is the doctrine of how you are going to lose Christianity and lose salvation as a Christian. Some people say you cannot. It's a lie. This Hebrews 12 is so clear that the son, not the servant, not the hireling, not the any other person, the born again son, that God does not chasten, is a bastard. You know the meaning of a bastard? Illegitimate child. That's the same thing Jesus said. You don't have to go there though. In Matthew chapter 7, 21 to 23. He says, many will say, Lord, Lord, did I not prophesy? Did I not cast out demons? But I will say, get out, I never knew. That's the same thing he's saying. So the reason for his chastening us, that's the whole reason. Now listen, I want you to see the importance. Maybe you should shoot to 5, 6 and come back to 10. I want to just do something so that I can emphasize. You've heard this exhortation, when God chastens you, Don't faint. 6, 6, 6, 6, 6, 6. For whom God loves. Now this is said twice in the New Testament. It's said here, And it said in Revelation chapter 3, I think verse 19 or so. So it says, for whom God loves, he chastens, and he scourges, that is to discipline, to flog every child. Now, if you endure chastening, God deals with you as sons. So that means the real dealing of a son is chastening. For what son is he whom his father chasteneth not? Now look at 8. That's where he's building. If you be without chastisement, where all are partakers, you cannot be a Christian without being chastened by God, then guess what? You are bastards and not sons. Don't move forward. Stay there. Did you see another all? Did you see another all? Where is the all? Now what is he saying? If you be without chastisement, wherefore what? So all Christians, what is one of the signs of all Christians? Chastisement. Is that so? What is the sign of all bastards? Lack of chastisement. Now let's go now to 10. 10. Just go straight to 10. It's just building up. Now, for wherefore? The natural fathers chastened us after their pleasure. But he, why does he chasten us? Why? How? That we might be partakers of his holiness. So can I tell you? If you are a true son of God, that means God, his whole work in your life is to chasten you so that you'll be a partaker of his holiness. If you are a bastard, it means God is not able to chasten you to be a partaker of his holiness. So answer the question, who is a bastard and who is a Christian? Answer the question, what is the gospel that is being preached in the mouths of men, able to do in the lives of men? Is it the type that is helping people to be chastened? Is it the type that is helping people to lay hold of the promises so that we can be partakers of his divine nature, partakers of his holiness, so that we can perfect holiness in the fear of the Lord? Why is there no power in the church? Why is there no reality of God in the church? Because there is no holiness. Because we are not perfecting holiness in the fear of God. I prove it to you one more time. Romans chapter 1 verse 4. And Jesus Christ was declared how? To be the Son of God. Why? With power. How? According to the Spirit of holiness. You see the power of Jesus Christ? You see the importance of this calling that we are called for? You see why everything that we are pursuing is all about perfecting holiness in the fear of the Lord? This is what makes us a peculiar people. That me and you, we will be contemplating holiness. What is holiness? This is the calling we are called to. We are called to holiness. It matters to us. It matters to us. It matters. There must be a separation. Everybody's going one way, you're going the other way, because this is not the way of holiness. There is a way of holiness. There is a highway that was prophesied that we will walk in. It's called the highway of holiness. It's Isaiah. Are you walking in that way? Jesus called it the narrow way. It's a way that constricts us. The psalmist called it the pathway of righteousness. It's a way by which you cannot do anything. God loves you if you like be a billionaire, if you like own anything, do anything. Just it must be in the highway of holiness. Just like Dave was saying earlier. We have to now understand we are a peculiar people. You see, sometimes people tell me I'm antisocial. Some people have even called me a hermit. And I'm not exceedingly very social, so people may not know that. Not for any reason, but because of my calling. Have you ever heard the saying, it's lonely at the top? It's very lonely there sometimes. You know why? Because there's a separation that must take place. There are some things, see, you must hate money. There are things that God is still dealing with me about. Listen, when you start meditating on scriptures, you will hate mammon. Have you seen a man give out all his money, his car, his biggest cars, and so tick, 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 tick. It's not crazy. The thing has hooked his heart. And he has found a revelation in God and knows the danger that covetousness is idolatry. He is fear. The Bible says he's watching over his soul. He's guarding his soul. He's fighting the fight of his soul. He's building a rich soul because he knows that this thing will kill me. He's hooked onto these things, and the love of money will kill him like it killed that rich man. It's the same thing. You must know those things. All you brothers here know it very well. If you call yourself a Christian and you're pursuing... I'm talking doctrine. You know, Ephesians talk doctrine from 1 to 3. From 4 to 6 is instruction. I'm going to brief instruction. These are practical. The 4 to 6, go and read. Do not lie. Do not cheat. Don't be angry and sin. It's practical from then on. We'll get there. But I can tell you ahead of time. Anybody here, you say you're a brother and you're looking for Christianity. If you do not settle this in your mind, do not tolerate women coming to shake their boom boom around you. Don't. Just kick it off. Go. Yeah, kick it off. Just help them a bit to be sensible. I don't need this. If it's a decent person who doesn't know what they are doing, say, come on, my dear sister, I don't need this. Don't need this. They will see them, they are all bodies on, charged up. Hey, sister, how are you? What are you? How are you in for? You're already in lust. Stop fooling yourself. Those things you close. Do you know grace trains us? I wasn't like this yesterday. I'm like this today. And if I continue in the grace of God, I continue to be like this. There are trainings you must do. There's a training for prayer. There's a training to read. There are things that offend God. This is offend God. I don't accept it. Keep your distance from me. You have to walk your salvation with fear and trembling. Yes. Yes, you have to. So I'm asking you practically. Because we can talk doctrine. After you leave here, doctrine, just sit down and just laugh. Don't mind the doctrine, let's go to practical. Practical. As you guys go there, that neighbor who came, say, come and teach me mathematics. Oh, you are a lodo. What you say? I knew mathematics when I was in school. You don't know it. You are just a lost. It's called lost. It's lostmatics. Lostmatics. It's not mathematics. It's lost driving you there, not mathematics. And I'm speaking to somebody here. You need to check yourself. Same with the women. I don't know, maybe my wife come and talk about women. I don't know the type of things women think about. Do you people have lust? Praise God. You have to work out your salvation. So the calling of God is doctrinal. But when we go beyond doctrine, it's practical. It's very practical. Do not, as a man, say you are going to carry a woman every day you are driving to the office. No, sorry. Except she's just your daughter. Don't. So once in a while, check yourself out. See, I said this once before and people took it in the wrong, misunderstood me. I am not exempt from attraction. My wife knows that. I get sometimes, there's some pretty girls around me that meet with me, and not bad. You think the pastors don't check out people? I do check out them. You know now. But one of the first things I know to make sure I'm not in lust is I should be able to discuss it with my wife. I see, you see this thought that came to my mind. See. Hey, what are you doing? What are you thinking about? Because she will first slap out the fear of God into my heart if it was not there, away from my heart. Now, on a serious note, you have to really work it out. You have to, don't give room to the devil. That's what the Bible says. Once you have started giving the room, it becomes more difficult. You know this position I have? It's so beautiful. Because I've talked like this. There are people on television listening. There are people around me. Every woman knows that she has to care for me. I've helped myself already. Announce it. Tell your people in your office. Let them see. Call you SU, anything. You are SU with capital letters. Don't be afraid. That is why we are a peculiar people. Yes. We're peculiar. People used to laugh at Deeper Life. They were Deeper Life. They were Deeper Life. They were the best brand of Christianity that we knew. The pure ones. They were the... I've been studying, and everybody, Deeper Life is legalistic. They captured there was a great measure of legalism, but they captured to a great essence an understanding of our identity in Christ. It's a calling to holiness. It's not fun. It's not games. It's something we are going to guard. We guard it jealously. We are a peculiar people. We have been called to show forth this marvelous light. It's not a game. It's such a whole, it's so divine. It's my purpose before I was born. Now, even our generation, we are afraid to talk about holiness. Do you know that? Do you know that in church today? People don't want to talk about holiness. Oh, why are you talking? This is legalism. Some devil, doctrine of devil has come in, and the whole essence for which we are, that God is trying to perfect us in holiness, that God is trying to chastise us so that we'll be perfected in holiness, and we are supposed to perfect this holiness, which we are called to. Guess what? Now we're afraid. Church is afraid to talk about holiness. We'd rather talk about faith. We'd rather talk about prosperity. We'd rather talk about what are the different things, entrepreneurship. Meanwhile, holiness is the cocoa of the matter. Without which, do you know what I mean of fundamental? I had to study fundamental. One day God was dealing me on the fundamentals. The fundamental of a thing is the real essence of the thing without which it ceases to be the thing. In other words, if I say this is iPhone, the fundamental of this phone is probably the operating system. If I take it out, it is just a thing. It's a thing that looks like iPhone. So imagine now, Pastor Bruno wrote me, design something, makes it white and blue, and just like this, and brings us an iPhone. You press it, it cannot have Apple inside of it. You press it, there's no app store. Just has, look at you, and it doesn't even come on. Nothing there, but says iPhone, because it looks like this. Is that mean it's an iPhone? Do you think because everybody say I'm a Christian, they are Christians? They are nothing. The fundamental of Christianity is the pursuit of holiness, the perfection of holiness, the chastisement in holiness. Without which you are nothing. You are just a talking man who has a form of godliness but denies the power that can make you godly.
Thank you for watching this Awakened Generation. We trust you've been inspired by this message. Tune in again to this channel at the same time to hear the heartbeats of God. Please send your testimonies, suggestions, or inquiries to testify@tbrchurch.org or info@tbrchurch.org. We would love to host you this Sunday by 10 a.m. Visit our website or contact us on the following numbers. Jesus is coming soon, so stay rapturable.